Hi everyone, welcome back. Well, the battle cry is on, everyone, and I hope we're all armored up. Continue taking the chinks out of our armor, digging deep in the word, prayer, repentance. Let's make sure we are completely spiritually checked up every time we can try to do it. Throughout the day, in the morning, before we go to sleep. Ask for forgiveness of our sins, because a lot of them we don't even know we're doing it. So, if we catch ourselves, we know we did something and slipped up, let's repent, ask God to change our hearts and take that stony hardness, that little, even if it's a little place, a little bit of darkness in our heart, let's ask him to take it out and give us his heart for that darkness. Let's continually pray, continually lift up our brethren and speak truth. Let us only speak truth and life and love and light. Please, this is what we need as a body, as a church. We have to do this, and we have to practice putting on our armor every day, every piece of it. We are in the battle, in the fight of our life right now. And what matters is our spiritual walk. Everything else is dung under our feet, everybody. We belong to the Most High. There is such power in that. We are victorious. We are overcomers. Yes, God revealed something to me, because I mean, my whole life I felt like a victim. And I hated it. And people looked at me like, what's wrong with your life? What have you done? You must really have done something to deserve that. I mean, I could just see it on their faces. And I even had a boss once say, you know, you're such a victim. I mean, I was like, what? I mean, I was in my 20s. And then, in my 30s, I got lupus. And I looked up about that illness, because that was when my real spiritual walk really truly began with God. And boy, has it been a long process. It's been a long road. It took a lot to find his truth. But he sent me what I needed. Oh, I could write a book on all that. I could write many books, but what's the point? Well, I looked up what lupus meant. And there's even a constellation lupus, by the way. You know what it means? The victim. Yeah. Yeah. See, Satan had marked me as a victim. I'm not his victim. I'm victorious over him. Yep. I sure am. Through the blood and the power of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit that lives within me. So we must, every day, put back the air that escapes out of us. See, Jesus gives, and he's empowered. We give, we get deflated, because we are not Jesus Christ. Why do I say this? When Jesus purposely went to the woman at the well, he hadn't eaten. And while the disciples were gone, he was thirsty and hungry, and he needed a rest. And they went out, the disciples went to get lunch. And while they were gone getting lunch, this is when Jesus knew, because he made sure he was alone with her. He orchestrates everything perfectly. And after he ministered to her, after he poured the Holy Spirit on her, his spirit, after he gave her truth of the living water, he had no need to eat or drink when his disciples returned. Because see, he was designed to fulfill us. And that empowers him. So the more power he gives to his children and those that he loved, that love him back and accept it, he just emboldens. That's why he's Jesus Christ, Yeshua. So, that said, we're going to pray. We're going to armor up and we're going to dig in deep today. First, before I pray, I want to tell you all, I appreciate each and every one of you. You have no idea the power of your prayers, the power of your support, and your hearts. It's the most beautiful thing I have ever experienced, and I've not even got to see you guys face to face. Tractors will come and go. Hey, the devil's got a job to do. He's going to do it. Only because God allows it. So we're going to push on together. Because we are one in spirit, everybody. And that's powerful. And the devil doesn't like it. But that's okay. Because we walk in the power of the resurrection of the cross. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. So with that said, let's pray. Father, I thank you that we're all together. This is by your hand and none other. I thank you for this ministry. I thank you for everything you have done and are doing and will do. Father, our hearts reach out to you. You know where there are still little corners of darkness. We ask that you take that from us and heal us and give us your heart, your light. Let us speak in love and life. And your words in our mouths, your purpose in our walk. Father, we know that you promise us so much glory from the tribulations of this life, and we thank you for that. And we know that if we are sitting here today, it is for your purpose. It is for your will, because you have something for us to do that's so important for you and your kingdom. And we know how precious that is, Lord. And let nothing, no darkness, no death, no destruction, no deceit ever come against that. Thank you, Father. Now we're going to recite the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth and in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil and the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In Jesus, Yeshua's precious name. Amen. 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 Okay. Sorry I get a little emotional, but my heart overflows with love for you guys, for anyone that hears my voice, because I know if they're here, it's only by the leading of the Holy Spirit, because this ministry, I do not advertise it. I do not accept money or donations, or even if somebody wanted to give it to me, I wouldn't take it. I do not get monetary ads on here. It has nothing to do with money. Our treasures are in heaven, not this flesh earth that's failing and deteriorating as we speak. That's all. Listen, money is just nothing but an illusion. I could have $1,000 bills sitting here, and they're, you know, there's going to come a time when I can use them for toilet paper because they have no intrinsic value. But yet people kill, lie, cheat, backstab, you name it, they do it for money. They'll sell their own mother out. Some kill their own parents over money. Some kill their most cherished loved one over money. It's the root of all evil. The love of money is the root of all evil. But when we have money, we use it for the kingdom. We use it for what God gives it to us for our sustenance. I can't speak today. Speaking of things with this ministry, it's 2017, so I always order calendars and pens and notepads and things like that at the beginning of the year. And I'm only going to have a limited amount. But if anybody would like to have some of these things, then when I just contact me, and as soon as I get them done and get them shipped to me, I'd be glad to share them with you and send them to you free of charge, okay? Just consider it my gift for being here. And if I run out, I run out. I'm sorry. So first come, first serve. But I will let you know when I receive them, okay? I'll be ordering them probably next week. Yeah. Oh, so, with that said, we got to dig in. We got some stuff to dig into today. Boy, do we. We're going to talk about David and Goliath. Because though we've heard this story many a times, and probably read it many a times, we really did not probably dig deep enough to know what it really means and what it's saying, okay? Yes. I'm going to tell you something. We are not slaves to the fear of men. No, we're not. We're not going to walk in insecurity and inferiority. Don't let the devil trick you that way. Because that negates your honor and your anointing and your walk with God. Did you know that? That's why the devil loves to use it. Mm-hmm. And you know, it takes away your ability to trust God and walk with Him. It does. And you end up in disobedience. And then you're open to the devil. So, just keep that in mind. Because Saul operated under this spirit. He even went to the witch of Endor, a seer, a psychic, you would call it. And he ended up getting an evil spirit. And he wished to kill David, right? David had a lot to contend with. David was just a young boy. Yeah, go read the story about David. It's amazing. And do you know the only time that David could calm Saul down, King Saul, was he would play the harp. And he and Saul would become refreshed and well, and the distressing and evil spirit that possessed him would depart. Did you know that? I had an inkling a while back. I guess it's probably been about 10, 12 years ago. I thought, I'd like to get a harp and learn how to play it. I never did, and I really think that would be awesome. I think they're beautiful instruments anyway. And I've only played woodwinds when I was in school. I probably don't even remember how to read music anymore anyway, so. But I would like to. Maybe one day in heaven I'll be playing the harp. I don't know. But with that said, we got to dig in, okay? So we're going to go to 1 Samuel, the book of 1 Samuel. Yep, 1 Samuel chapter 17, okay? Because we're going to talk about David and Goliath. There's just such an abundance of golden treasures, nuggets in this scripture, and it does apply for us today. Oh, and by the way, you know CERN, you know, the one with the symbol 666, and you know, it's all just so soaked and evil and tied to the bottomless pit and all that, and the throne of Apollyon and all, temple of Apollyon and that. You know what? They have these two large magnets for the Hadron Collider. And they've named them David and Goliath. If you don't think that the evil know what they're doing and their plan and their own agenda, this is what hurts the church. This is what hurts God's people. Because they don't see. Because God reveals it to you. Why do you think they named it David and Goliath? Because God was going to let that open your eyes and go, whoa, wait a minute. What is that all about? See? And then you dig. So with that said, let's get into David and Goliath. So we are going to 1 Samuel chapter 17. Now, listen to this. What does the number 17 mean? It means victory. Yes, it does. God's word is constructed so perfectly. I've said that over and over. And the more you dig, the more you realize it. Hey, if you want to get a list of the biblical numerics, meaning this is not numerology, by the way, go to asis.com and... or Google that and Google biblical numerics, and it should bring up the page, and it has a graph in there, and you can just print the graph. Okay, it's pretty interesting. I mean, mine, I've had this chart forever, and I've printed it over and over and shared it. And I had so many notes on the old one, and I don't know where I've put it, so I had to replace it. But I'm sure the old one will turn up, so. But with that said, it really is amazing. Because if you're digging into the word, you can look up what these numbers mean that are the most significant in the Bible. And it really opens up the scripture to you, so. We're going to go to 1 Samuel 17, verse 1, right now. Now the Philistines gathered together their armies to battle and were gathered together at Shoshah, which belongeth to Judah, and pitched between Shoshah and Azekah in Ephesidamim. Okay? Well, you know who the Philistines were. They were the enemy to Israel. There were giants in there because Goliath was a Philistine. And we know that the giants were from the fallen angels mating with women and creating children. And these giants did not have souls from God because they were not of God's creation. They are not made in His image. They are not given a spirit, a soul from God, because they were not part of His plan or His creation. But the devil started this in the garden, and it continued. And this was after the flood of Noah. So there was a second influx of fallen angels that did the same thing as they did before. So that's what he's fighting here. Okay. And what does this name mean? This Soko. What does it mean? Well, it is a place named in Palestine, right? Remember, Palestine at that time belonged to Judah. Well, it means, in the primitive root and meaning, it means to shut in, protection, restraint, a fence, a hedge. Okay? That's the name of that city. Well, David was protected. He was protected by God. He had a fence and a hedge around him. Remember in the book of Job, Satan was walking around accusing everybody that, you know, telling God how terrible his children were. And God was like, oh, have you considered my servant Job? He's like, oh, you know, the devil says, you got a hedge around him. That's why he only worships you and does not curse you. But take that hedge away from him and let me have him for a little while. And I bet you he'll curse you to your face, Lord. That's what the devil said to God. So you know what? God removed that hedge. And he let the devil, he said, you can do whatever, but you cannot take his life. The Job Syndrome video that I posted is so powerful that Mike from around the world did at the Council of Time. That really touched me. I only share things that are very, very important and urgent and true, okay? And that was an awesome, awesome study that he gave. And I'll tell you why. Because it's so apparent. So apparent that this man, Mike, whoever he is, has been through that. And anybody who's been through the Job syndrome, God really bestows blessings on them. Because that's the devil's ultimate goal, is to get you to curse God. Yep. Mm-hmm. But we have hedge around us, everybody. We do. We are like Job in some way, shape, or form. Yes, we are. So let's go back to verse 1. I'm going to pick this apart because you wouldn't believe what's in it. Just a refresh. Now the Philistines gathered together their armies to battle and were gathered together at Soko. Okay, Soko means, like I said, a fence, a hedge, protection. This was protection for Judah, all right? That is the tribe that this is talking about. Because Saul was the king of Judah, okay? So it means just that. And that's what brought up the what I was talking about with Job. And it says, which belongeth to Judah, and pitched between Sukkot and Azekah in Ephesidemon. Okay, what does Azekah mean? It means tilled land, to have a fence about. Yes, it does. And it goes even farther. It means the signet ring as engraved, like a signet ring of a king, or a signet, an engraving of the king. Yeah, you see, and you know who our king is. And then, when you look at this word, Ephesidemon, well, it's actually pronounced Ephesidemon, okay? This is going to blow your mind. It means a dam or a boundary of blood drops. Yes, it does. Isn't that amazing? A cessation, such as in, meaning no further. The ankle, the extremity of the leg or foot, the end, howbeit less than nothing, nevertheless, where no, none, beside, not any, withstanding, thing of naught, uttermost part, want without cause. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Isn't that amazing? And it comes from the word aphos, which means to disappear, cease, be clean, gone, at an end, brought to naught, to fail. Yes. How fitting for today, we're talking about the flood, the dam, the flood of the dragon. Really, I mean, I had no idea this was even in here till I took a look at it today. Yes, a dam of blood drops, and it's a drawing line, it's an ending. Cessation, an end, especially of the earth. Wow. And why is this so important about the leg and the feet? Well, as we go on, we're going to find out more of what it talks about in this chapter. But it lines up just with Daniel's dream about the empires and the big giant statue with the feet of iron and clay. Yes, it will. It's all tied in there, everybody. See, there's giants. They're just not the way they were back then. It's amazing. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and pitched by the valley of Elah and set the battle in array against the Philistines. Listen, this valley of Elah, so important. I do believe it's going to be tied with the deadly wound in its original location. And this valley of Elah really, really plays in the end times. And what does valley mean? Well, valley, you know how when we say Psalm 23 and we say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Well, it's a vale. V-A-L-E, a dale, you know, a valley, meaning a broad depression in the land. But you know spiritually that means something more. And that's why I have really worked hard on Psalm 23 in my older videos. It is miraculous, it is powerful, and we make the terrible mistake of thinking that that is a prayer for the dead, because it is for the living, and it's in our walk with Christ, every bit of it. So it's a deep, broad depression in the earth. Look, it's talking about the end of the times. That's what it's referring to. That's what it means for us today. But it meant something so more. And you'll see how what Daniel did in the Valley of Elah, in the brook, and the stones he picked up to kill Goliath, you'll see. It's amazing how it's tied to the end times. Okay? And let's go here. Verse 3. And the Philistines stood on a mountain and on the side. And Israel stood on a mountain on the other side. And there was a valley between them. Well, it's the Valley of Elah. And there went out a champion. Now this word champion is talking about a men of renown, the giants. It's tied to today, as in, means an individual or a male. Now you got to remember, these champions, these giants, were of the fallen angels. Their DNA was totally defiled. All right, they did not have souls given by God. They were devils. They had souls of devils, because they were not souls that were born of God. And so when they were all killed, those souls are the demons that possess people today and bother people and everything. Those are the demonic souls. So it's really amazing how this all ties in for today, everyone. Because fallen angels have created children again through man, through the hand of man and genetic modification and chimeras and all that stuff. It really is. Okay, and his name was Goliath. All right, and went out a champion of the camp of Israel. Okay. Sorry about that. You would not believe what I have been through in the last few days to get studies out. Oh, Lord. I mean, it is like the devil is ramping it up, and I am not going to lose my peace, and he can't stand this power that we're putting out here, because this is warfare. And he knows this is his demise. And he doesn't want this message out, everyone. I promise you that. All right, so, and there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath. First of all, let's look at the name Philistines. What does that word mean? Rolling, migratory. It was a region in Syria, everybody. Mm-hmm. Yep. To roll in the dust, roll and wallow self. Well, who was cursed to lick the dust of the earth the rest of his days? Satan. Yeah. And so, out of the camp of the Philistines named Goliath. What does Goliath mean? It means exile. Hmm. He's exiled from the kingdom of heaven, I can promise you that. It means to denude in a disgraceful sense, to exile, a captive usually being stripped, to reveal, to advertise, appear, bewray, bring, carry, lead, go, captive, into captivity, depart, disclose, discover, exile, begone, open, plainly publish, remove, reveal, shamelessly show, surely tell, uncover. Yeah. His his evil was going to be completely put to shame. Named Goliath of Gath.
Well, what does Gath mean?
Well, Gath means... Oops. I'm not having a good time here, everyone. I'm telling you. I apologize. I wish this was going smoother. Alright. It's a city. A Philistine city. And it means... treading out grapes, a wine press, a vat for holding grapes and pressing them, a wine press. Yes, well,
guess what?
That's what's going to happen when the angels reap the wicked in the cup of wrath. Yep, it sure does. That's what's going to happen. Angels are going to gather and put them in the wine press. Yep. And it's going to be sweet music to God's ears and the angels when they do this, because it's going to cleanse the evil from the earth. These hybrids, these things that are not human beings, okay, that were of that land. So, named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. Six. Well, look at that number. Isn't that amazing? Six. Well, we all know this giant's had 6 fingers also, everyone. 6 fingers, 6 toes. And we know what this number 6 means. And he was 6 cubits and a span. It's pretty big, everybody. Really big. Big guy. So, you can see that 666 is tied to this because he had 6 fingers, 6 toes, and he was 6 cubits and a span. And he had a helmet of brass. Well, I'm going to tell you something about brass and iron. It's part of the beast. Remember, it has teeth of iron, nails of brass. Mm-hmm. This is all going to be tied in here, everybody. So he had a helmet of brass upon his head. Well, we wear the helmet of salvation, do we not? Yeah, we do. But what does brass do? What's used brass used as? In God's word. Well, it's part of the beast, everybody. It's the nails of the beast. Thought I had a note on brass and iron. Had a study on it. I was going to share it. It was really deep, though. And I thought we better start with some more basic things. Because I tell you, whenever I get into the book of Daniel, and I'm sorry that we haven't gone back there, but... the book of Daniel is sealed up for the end times. And I don't think it's totally been revealed of who's who and what's what. I am being led to really believe that the he-goat is more than likely Putin. Because Russia is Rush, which is Edom. And is of the tribe of Esau, and Esau is the second father of the Muslims, the Arab peoples. So that's why he's over there. He's positioning himself for the end. He really is, everybody. I do know that. And I do believe that Hillary and Obama are in bed with him. Yep, I do. But we're going to know when we're going to know, right? God deems it to be revealed. So just remember, brass means filthiness, everybody. It also means filthiness. It means like a cheap metal instead of gold or silver. So copper, chains, fetters. Yeah. Yeah. It's chains, everybody. And we're, he is in wearing a helmet of chains. Period. It's not life upon his head. And he was armed with a coat of mail. Alright, what does that mean? Mail. To shale off his bark, the scales of a fish. Hence, a coat of mail is composed of covering with jointed plates of metal, mail, scale. Well, it's like Leviathan, everybody. Because that's who he's of. And the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of brass. Mm-hmm. Covered in this brass, isn't he? Yep. And he had greaves of brass upon his legs and a target of brass between his shoulders. So his armor was made out of this brass. Mm-hmm. He sure did. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam. Yeah, weaver's beam. Well, what does that mean? We all know what a weaver is. Beam, like a yoke, properly for plowing, the frame of a loom, a beam. Well, it's not the yoke that we put on for Christ. This is bondage, everybody. This is something to break up the earth, break up God's creation. You understand? And his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. Do you see? Here's the brass and iron, everybody. 600 shekels. All right, here we go back to six. What does 600 mean in biblical numerics? It means war, everybody. He was a man of war, warfare against God's people of iron. 600 shekels of iron. Well, he had to be pretty strong to even wear this stuff, right? What does iron do? It's used for cutting. It's an axe head. Mm-hmm. It's all part of the beast. Mm-hmm. Yep. So you can see the beast is all wrapped up in Goliath. And we have personal Goliaths too. But just as David did, we can slay it with our Lord Jesus Christ. One bearing a shield went before him. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Verse 8, and he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, where are ye come out to set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and you are servants to Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight with me and to kill me, then will we be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall you be our servants and serve us. Now listen, these giants were evil people. They were evil. They were cannibals. And they were just ungodly creatures of the deeps of hell. Okay? These are the little spirits that bother us and try to really oppress people and possess people. Yeah, it really is. Verse 10, and the Philistine said, I defy the armies of Israel this day. Give me a man that we may fight together. When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Well, they were scared. They were scared. They were not walking in the power of God. They forgot who they were. Now David was the son of that Ephrathite of Bethlehem, Judah, whose name was Jesse, and he had 8 sons. And the man went among men for an old man in the days of Saul. And the 3 eldest sons of Jesse went and followed Saul to the battle. So they were in the army. And the names of his 3 sons that went to battle were Eliab, the firstborn, and the next unto him, Abinadab, and the third, Shammah. Let's look at what these names mean. Eliab. First of all, he was the firstborn, right? It means God of his father. That's what it means. Eliab. And then you have the next one, the second oldest, was Abinadab. And that means father of generosity. And then the third one was Shema. That sounds like a familiar word, doesn't it? Yeah, Shema. Means ruin by implication, consternation, astonishment, desolation, waste, wonderful thing. Ruin. Yeah. See, there was a little problem in the family of David. And unfortunately, it influenced him as he got older, too. But for now, he's a young boy. And David was the youngest, and the three eldest followed Saul. So David, it means loving. Yes, David. That's really how it's said in the Hebrew, David. And it means loving. To properly to boil, to love. By implication, a love, a token, a lover, a friend, and specifically an uncle, well-beloved, father's brother, love, uncle. Also means a pot for boiling, resembling the shape of a basket, a cauldron, a kettle, a seething pot. Yeah, well, David was going to show this Philistine, I can tell you that. But David went and returned to Saul to feed his father's sheep at Bethlehem. He was just a kid, everybody. And the Philistine drew near morning and evening and presented himself 40 days. What's 40, everybody? 40 days in the wilderness, 40 days on Mount Sinai for Moses. It means trials, probation, testings. It's testing. 40 days. Okay, he was testing them. They were going through a testing. Do you understand? The Philistine, Goliath, was testing them for 40 days. That's over a month, everybody. I mean, this went on for a long time. And Jesse said unto David, his son, take now for your brothers an ephah of this parched corn and these 10 loaves, and run to the camp to thy brethren, and carry these 10 cheeses unto the captain of their 1,000, and look how thy brethren's face, and take their pledge. He's telling them, go feed them, check on them. 10 cheeses. Well, what does the number 10 mean? It means testimony, law, and responsibility. Okay? Now Saul and they and all the men of Israel were in the valley of Elah fighting with the Philistines. And David rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with a keeper, and took and went as Jesse had commanded him. And he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight, and shouted for the battle. For Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army. They were really battling it out, okay? And David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper of the carriage, and ran into the army, and came and saluted his brethren. And he talked with them. Behold, there came up the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath, by name, out of the armies of the Philistine, and spake according to the same words, and David heard them. So, this guy, this giant, is just, he's just tormenting Israel. And this is how giants do in our lives. They just come back, keep coming up, coming up, coming up, aggravating you, threatening you, frightening you. That's how they work. Because fear is their power, okay? David heard all this. Verse 24, and all the men of Israel, when they saw the men, they fled from him and were sore afraid. The armies of Israel saw Goliath and were so afraid they ran away. And the men of Israel said, have ye seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel is he come up. And it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will give him his daughter, and make his father's house free in Israel. Wow, they're like saying, hey, whoever will go up against him, you're gonna be so blessed. The king is just going to kiss your feet, give you everything you want, even give you his daughter. And David spake to the men that stood by him, saying, what shall be done to the man that killeth this Philistine and taketh away the reproach from Israel? For who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? Here, out of the mouth of a babe, right? A kid. Oh, yeah. And uncircumcised means pretty, you know, it just means in the Jewish, they were all to be circumcised. And it was like their sacrifice with their sons, okay? And it was a bond, a covenant with God. Now our circumcision is of the heart. It has nothing to do with a body part. It's of your heart. It's a spiritual thing, okay? And the people answered him after this manner, saying, so shall it be done to the man that killeth him. Yeah, they're documenting, double stating, this is what's going to happen. Whoever gets this guy, you know. And Eliab, his eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled against David. And he said, why camest that thou down hither? He's like, why are you here? And with whom have you left those few sheep in the wilderness? Okay, think about this spiritually. The sheep in the wilderness. His brother's all worried about the sheep in the wilderness, but if they lose this battle against Goliath and the Philistines, they're going into bondage, everybody. They're going to go serve them. And they're going to treat them like the Jews were treated in the Holocaust, okay? That's really what's going to happen if they don't win this battle. So, you know, we are sheep. Think about this, okay? And this is a battle that's being fought right now, but Jesus Christ has already won this battle. And we defeat Goliath by him. And so his brother Eliab's all worried about the sheep, you know. I know thy pride and the naughtiness of your heart, for you have come down that thou mightest see the battle. He's like, you just want to know what's going on. You got darkness in your heart. You're thinking dark thoughts. You just want to see the drama. Mm-hmm. And David said, what have I now done? Is there not a cause? So David's confused. He's like, listen, what have I done now? I'm here for a cause. I'm coming here to stand up to remind you whose people we are and the power in that. And he turned from him toward another and spake after the same manner. And the people answered him again after the former manner. And when the words were heard which David spake, they rehearsed them before Saul. And he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail because of him. Thy servant will go and fight this Philistine. David, you got to give it to him, you know? What a really brave and loyal heart he had for God. He's like, look, I'm under the God Almighty. I'm not afraid of this guy. And your all's hearts are failing, you know? It's like, he's scaring you to death. And Saul said to David, thou art not able to go against the Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth. And he's a man of war from his youth. And David said unto Saul, thy servant kept his father's sheep, and there came a lion and a bear and took a lamb out of the flock. And I went after him and smote him and delivered him out of his mouth. And when he arose against me, I caught him by his beard and smote him and slew him. He's like, look, I have fought lions, bears, I have been a keeper of my father's sheep. See, he was a type of Christ, okay? And out of him, out of his root and his branch, comes Christ will come out of that king line, okay? And he's, it's funny, I'm sorry, I think it's cute. And he's like, he's telling, hey, you know, this is nothing. I already took care of a lion and a bear. And thy servant slew both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine should just be one of them, seeing he has defiled the armies of the living God. He's shamed you, is what David is saying. He's like, He's shamed you. He's defied you. He's betrothed you to threaten you and take you as servants. He's put you in jeopardy and reproach, and he wants to pull you just to pieces and expose you and strip you and put you into bondage. And he's like, no, no. That's what he says. He's like, no. And he says, David said, moreover, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of the Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go, and the Lord be with thee. This is how we are to handle our giants, everybody. Exactly like this. And we talk about our Father just like this. And we totally give him the power that he is, the credit that he is. We do not fear these giants. There is no fear when you walk with the Lord. And Saul armed David with his armor, and he put a helmet of brass upon his head. And he armed also him with a coat of mail. So Saul put on David what Philistine had on. Okay? And David girded his sword upon his armor, and he essayed to go, for he had not proved it. And David said unto Saul, I cannot go with these, for I have not proved them. And David put them off. Okay, so what David is saying, he's like, look, I have not even tried this stuff before. This is not how I fight. Okay? He's like, no, I don't even want this stuff. He took it off. Okay? And he took his staff in his hand. Yeah. The staff that he uses when he's herding the sheep, everybody. And beating off the lions and the bears and getting them off away from his sheep. And he chose him 5 smooth stones out of the brook. Well, this is out of the brook of Elah, okay? Now, 5. 5 means grace. Now, these smooth stones, everybody. Remember when we were studying the mark of the beast and to count the number of the beast? And it's talking about smooth stones, white and black. Well, there's going to be 4 of these left, reserved for today, okay? And he took his staff in his hand, and he chose him 5, for grace, smooth stones out of the brook, and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, even in a scrip, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. And the Philistine came on and drew unto David, and the man that bare the shield went before him. See, this Goliath has a little guy in front of him with a shield. He's not even like going to the front, okay? David recognized this. He's like, look, why's he got this guy? You know, David was like, what in the world? And when the Philistine looked about and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of a fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto David, am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods, okay, by Goliath's gods, which you know who his gods were, and it's not our God. And the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field. Then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. And this day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. And it came to pass, when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. Okay, David had no fear. He knew he was going forth in the power of the living God. He knew who he belonged to. David put his hand in the bag and took thence a stone and slung it and smote the Philistine in his forehead. that the stone sunk into his forehead and he fell upon his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and with a stone and smote the Philistine and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath therefore and slew him and cut off his head therewith. And when the Philistines saw their champion was dead, they fled. They had their big old bully. Their big old giant. Mm-hmm. Cannibal. Yep. And they saw that and they were scared to death and they ran. They're like, this little kid. Wow, he's really under the power of their God. They were scared to death that God's going to strike them all dead. And the men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines until thou come to the valley and to the gates of Ekron. And the wounded of the Philistines fell down by the way to Shechem, even unto Gath and unto Ekron. What's Ekron? First of all, what's a gate? Okay, it's an opening. It can be even considered a window, everybody. It's a city, a door, a gate, a port, an opening. In the spiritual sense, we have gates and doors and openings. And remember, we talked about the door of our shield. That's our door to open it to God, for his power to come through. And it shuts the doors of demons, everybody. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Think about that. Isn't that amazing? So, they came to the valley and to the gates of Ekron. It means eradication. Akar. That's where it comes from, the word Akar. Meaning to pluck up by the roots, specifically to hamstring, figuratively to exterminate, dig down, hoe, pluck up, root up. Think about that. It's all got a meaning, everyone. And the wounded of the Philistines fell down by the way to Shechem. That means double gates. It was a place in Palestine. It also means an opening, door, gate, city, door, gate, port. Mm-hmm. Sure does. Mm-hmm. Means same thing as gate. To act as a gatekeeper. To shower. To estimate. Think. To split or open. Yep. The power of the living God came through there. It's a holy land, everybody. Do you see? Do you see why there's a holy war going on there to this day? Even unto Gath and unto Ekron. And the children of Israel returned from chasing after the Philistines, and they spoiled their tents. Hey, they took it all. They took everything for a spoil. And David took the head of the Philistine and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his armor in his tent. And when Saul saw that David go forth against the Philistine, he said unto Abner, the captain of the host, Abner, whose son is this youth? And Abner said, as thy soul liveth, O king, I cannot tell. And the king said, inquire thou whose son this stripling is. And as David returned from the slaughter of the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the head of the Philistine in his hand. And Saul said to him, whose son art thou, young man? And David answered, I am the son of thy servant Jesse the Bethlehemite. Yeah. Exactly where Christ would be born. Mm-hmm. Little kid. Isn't that amazing? So, we don't fear. We're going to battle, everybody, and we have no fear in us. We are not going to fear those giants. We have the power of the living God with us. So that was pretty darn deep, wasn't it? Especially for what we're looking at today with what's happening in the earth and the times. And we need to go into the valley of God's strength, you know. We're going to that mountaintop. We are going to that victory. We have the victory. Remember what I told you. God told me And everything just looked like I was a victim, a victim, a victim. He told me, he said, you are no longer a victim. You are not just a survivor. You are more than an overcomer. You are a conqueror in Christ Jesus Yeshua. That is what the Lord put in my soul. And it was right then that Jesus led me to understand. And he spoke to my heart. And he said, you rest. You feast on my word. You rest in me. And I will fight. Because that's where our power lies, everyone. It's in him. It is in him. And when we praise him and we speak his power and we use our mouths to praise him, to lift him up, to thank him, to claim the power that is within us, that's when we're going to see mountains move. Yeah. Because Jesus said, faith, even the size of a mustard seed, will move a mountain. We have to build up our faith, everybody. And it all comes from the power of our mouth. That's why the devil gets us to try to say things and get frustrated and comes after us and makes us want to defend ourselves and everything else. Because, see, then we're not speaking the power of the living God. He's got us in our own little battle we can't win. Yep, that's the key right there. And I'm going to tell you a little more about David here. What did Jesus say in Revelations about the key of David to the churches? Oops, I'm dropping my stuff. He said, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, that's brotherly love, everyone, these things says he that is holy, he that is true, he that has the key of David, he that opens and no man shuts, and shuts and no man opens. There's your door, everybody, on your shield of faith. I know your works. I have set before you an open door, and no man can shut it. For you have a little strength, and you've kept my word, and have not denied my name. What did Jesus say in Matthew 16:19 about the keys? And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. That's power, everybody. That's control through the Most High God, our Lord of Lords and our King of Kings. In Isaiah 22:22 says, and the key of the house of David will I lay on his shoulder, so he shall open and none shall shut, and he shall shut and none shall open. That was the prophetic prophecy of Christ right there. Now, what does 22 mean? Remember, that says Isaiah 22:22. So it's a double witness. 22 means light. Isn't that amazing? Remember, 16 again, Matthew 16. Means love. Remember that that number has just come up over and over in our studies just in the last few days. And 19 means faith. Yes. If we have love of Christ and faith in him, that is the power to give us the kingdom, the keys to the kingdom of heaven. For us, he will give them to us. And whatever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever we loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Do you see why Satan comes against us? To keep us from praying, to keep us from worshiping, to keep us from reading the word. I mean, he knows this is the power to defeat him. And let me tell you something. Thank you, Stacy, by the way, Stacy S.
thank you for staying on top of that video for me that I worked on since 7 a.m. yesterday to get it out. And I'm telling you, I had every problem with my new computer. Everything went wrong. And couldn't get the voice to come out. It was all garbled up. And finally, I get it all done at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I finally got it done. And I loaded it up. And I've not been feeling well and sleeping well at night. So I just went up and down all night. And I was like, oh, I wonder if that video published. And I looked at 4 o'clock, 4:30 this morning, and it wasn't on there. And I had gotten no notification or anything. So I uploaded it again. Well, I looked, and here it was not posting it. And so I thought I took care of it, so I did it again. And then Stacy let me know that it wasn't on, that it said it had a copyright strike. Then I got an email that it had a copyright strike, which was crazy because there is no way that I was violating any copyright. Because first of all, the person that made the video took a preacher, his voice and his sermon, and put it to video. And it had a copyright for fair use notice on it. So he was using the copyright fair notice for use, which I was doing the same thing for educational purposes. And they just kept striking me and striking me. And so I was thinking, okay, I even tried it, you know, taking parts out and everything like that, and they still were giving me a copyright strike. And so I told Stacy, please pray, because I'm telling you, the enemy does not want this out. And we have to pray, because I'm telling you, I would have still been chasing my tail had not God just took it over and did what he had to do to get it right. And I never got any kind of notification that it was posted from YouTube or anything. Stacy is the one that let me know that it was back up. So thank you, Stacy. Thank you so much, my darling, because I was getting really tired and I was frustrated, but it was so important that I put that out. I knew how important it was. I know how powerful it is. It's a powerful study. It's a powerful, powerful thing. And I felt God moving through me when I was doing it. And there was no way I was going to give up. I was not going to give up. And instead of me having to sit here and still try to figure out how to get it on there, we prayed. And the Lord took care of it. So thank you, Stacy. Thank you for anybody that prayed. Thank you. Thank you. I really appreciate it. So still talking about David, okay? He represents the lion, the king, the Christ, strength. And the nature of Christ is that he is both a lion and a lamb to his people and a fierce lion to the disobedient. Listen, he is a defender, a protector. And though the lion is a threat to the lamb, our King of Kings is no threat to the lambs, everyone. He is our defender. We have a lion as a defender. What did Christ say in Revelation 5, which is grace, right? Grace. Revelation 5, verse 4. And I wept much because no man was worthy. This is John speaking. I apologize. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said to me, weep not. See the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals in there. Mm-hmm. Psalm 7. Unless he tears my soul like a lion, tearing it to pieces, while there is none to deliver. Let's go to Psalm 7. Didn't we just cover Psalm 7 the other day? I think we did. Let's go to Psalm 7. I had some other things I wanted to cover today, but O Lord my God, in thee do I put my trust. Save me from all them that persecute me and deliver me. lest he tear my soul like a lion, rending it in pieces while there is none to deliver. O Lord my God, if I have done this, if there be iniquity in my hands, if I have rewarded evil unto him that was at peace with me, yea, I have delivered him that without a cause is mine enemy. Let the enemy persecute my soul and take it. Yea, let him tread down my life upon the earth and lay my honor in the dust. Selah. Arise, O Lord, in thine anger. Lift up thyself because of the rage of mine enemies, and awake for me to the judgment that thou hast commanded. Who are our enemies? It is Satan and his minions. So it is. Because, see, he operates through people, everybody. So someone might seem to be your enemy as a person, but they are being just a puppet of Satan, believe me. Pray for your enemies, see? That's why. Because they are afflicted by the devil. Verse 7, so shall the congregation of the people compass thee about for their sakes, therefore return thou on high. The Lord shall judge the people. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to my integrity that is in me. What is in us, everybody? It's Jesus. He is our advocate. This is why there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus, because we're covered. We're covered. Our sins are forgiven. The blood is a covering. It's a covenant. The Lord shall judge the people. Judge me, O Lord, according to my righteousness and according to mine integrity that is in me. O, let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just, for the righteous God trieth their hearts and reins. Do you see this? Do you know what your reins are? Your reins are, in this perspective of the Hebrew, it's your kidneys. An essential organ. But it's tied, in reality, it's tied to the mind, the interior self. Isn't that strange? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Something prepared, an apparatus, an implement, utensil, dress, vessel, or weapon, armor bearer, artillery, bag, carriage, furnish, furniture, instrument, jewel, that is made of one from another, that which pertaineth a pot, a psaltery, a sack, a stuff, a thing, a tool, a vessel, a ware, a weapon, whatsoever. Wow. Yeah. Pretty amazing. God's word is just so amazing. So he tries the hearts and the reins. You understand? He investigates them. He examines them. He proves them. He puts them through trial. Puts them in the fire. Why? To test the metals. And he's going to put you in the fire to remove all the garbage elements so that you're pure and refined. You're his. He's transforming us. He really is. Verse 10, my defense is of God, which saveth the upright in heart. God judgeth the righteous, and God is angry with the wicked every day. So, if you think God doesn't get angry, if you think God doesn't have emotions, let me tell you something. He is fed up with the devil. He's hurt for his people. He's hurt for his creation. But he is angry with the wicked. Yes, he is. If he turn not, he will whet his sword. He hath bent his bow and made it ready. He hath also prepared for him the instruments of death. He ordained his arrows against the persecutors. Behold, he travaileth with iniquity and hath conceived mischief and brought forth falsehood. That's what the evil does. That is what the enemy does. Do you understand? Do you understand? Behold, he travaileth with iniquity and hath conceived mischief and brought forth falsehoods. So who's the father of lies? We know it's the devil. He made a pit and digged it, and has fallen into the ditch which he made. See, I'm going to tell you something about this, though. What he's done is for us. He digs a pit for us. And there's times when he'll actually throw us in there, just like Joseph got thrown in there, in the pit, in the well. And he plans to bury you alive. But your Savior is what prevents that from happening. And he lifts you up. And he turns that pit Satan dug for us, and he ends up in that pit. Do you understand? 16, his mischief shall return upon his own head, and his violent dealings shall come down upon his own pate. I will praise the Lord according to his righteousness, and will sing praise to the name of the Lord Most High. Amazing, isn't it? You just remember who Jesus Christ is. Revelation 22. Oh, wow. 22 again. Isn't that amazing? Revelation 22:16. Remember, that's light and love. This is Jesus talking about. I, Jesus, has sent my angel to testify to you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David and the bright and morning star. Well, he's not the fake morning star. There are. Lucifer tries to impersonate Jesus Christ. He is a mocker of God. He's nothing but an imitator, everyone. He loves to just copycat. He's a copycat. He really is. He's a mocker, a copycat. He's playing God. And his days of playing God are coming to an end, everybody. So what looks like hell on earth, you just have to remember God is with us. God is protecting us. And even though we're only congregating online, God brought us all together for a reason. And my blessed sister Jeanette, she sent me an awesome video about that prophecy, about how God uses technology of today to bring together his people and the power, and that he has reserved a place for us, and he will take us, and he's put people all over. See, this is what when you listen to the news, when you listen to the world, the first thing they want to say is, where is your God? That's really what they're saying. Every time they tell you a news story, every time they show you something, nowadays they're like toning down the stuff, okay? They really are. But every time they show something for, you know, to dramatize it and to just embellish it, and that's how they get their ratings. And that's really what they're yelling, because they're the heathen. I mean, they are. They're just, it's the voice of the devil. And he's like, where is your God? See, this is what's going on. Where is your God? I mean, they don't even want to tell you good news. There is good news. There's miracles every day. And they're not going to report that, because that they don't want to report, because they are in darkness. I mean, you just have to look at who owns the media, everybody. It's just amazing. So just remember that, because he's got people all over the world in his body for different purposes. And our God is supreme, and he's on the throne, and he's in control. And though he's letting this wickedness go for just a little while, it's not going to be long, everybody. He's going to cleanse it. But we are in his protection. We have nothing to fear. We have to trust him, no matter what it looks like. And if we're suffering and everything else, you know, just remember, he's just putting us in the fire. He's going to deliver us. Because there's one thing I have come to learn, everyone. When I am at the end and I cannot take it another second of it, and I cry out for him, I know my deliverance is coming real soon. I'm at the very end. You know, right when you want to give up, right when you'd rather just lay down and die, don't do it. Because that is the very end before you get delivered of that situation or that problem or that issue. Doesn't mean another one's not going to come. But right when you think you can't make it another foot, another step, He's gonna reach down and pull you up, just like when Peter was down in that water and he thought he was gonna drown and Christ just pulled him back up. I'm telling you. And he only lets us go through that because he's strengthening us and he's building up our faith in him. Because see, then every time you're gonna remember, well, he did this and he did that and he did it then and he did it then and he did it before and he did it on that time and he gave me the strength and when I thought I wasn't gonna make it another day, he pulled me up then. See, and then you know and your soul knows and your mind knows and your heart knows that he is just about to pull you up out of that water. He knows when you can't take anymore. He's not gonna break you. He'll bring you to the end of yourself. But he's not going to let you just go down the tubes. And when you are weak, that's when you're the strongest with him. Believe me, I am not preaching something just because it's written in a book. I am telling you what he's done in my life, time after time after time after time. He has delivered me over and over and shown me. And it's the only reason I could hang on today. Because I know that no matter what comes, I'm in his protective wing. He's going to deliver me. He's going to deliver you. We're going into the promised land, everybody. We're going to make it. We're going to the other side. Don't put your eyes on the devil. What did Peter do? God, he walked on the water. But when did he fall? When he started taking notice of the storm and the elements and the threats around him. When he took his eyes off Jesus Christ and he looked at the problem, he looked at the threat, he went down under. And Jesus was faithful and he pulled him up. He wasn't going to let him drown. He told him what he was going to do in his life. And let me tell you something, we are living in a time like no other. We're going to see the return of our Lord. We're going to see him rule with a rod of iron and set things straight and put an end to this wickedness and this evil, because evil is really, really out of control, everybody. And I'm going to tell you something, I pray for these people in California. Because there is a very huge treachery of lies and deceit going on there, everyone. And there's no reason for it other than it's purposed by the hand of evil. You know, I just seen the other day on a person's channel that I watch occasionally, they showed that the new $50 bill folded shows the Orville Dam. The spillway. Yeah. I mean, we saw it on the money on 9/11. Now we know why there's an all-seeing eye and a pyramid and all that stuff. And it says in God we trust, but what God are they really referring to? I don't think it's our God, everyone. We've been in confusion. They are lying to these people. They're not giving them adequate warning. Okay? I haven't watched the news at all today, but listen, there's been no warning for these flood victims. And they ended up having to evacuate 50,000 people out of San Jose, California, after they were already getting flooded out. But they did not give the heed, the call, the warning, or provide the resources or do anything they should have done as a government. And do you know that San Jose is the third largest city in California? It sure is. And it's named after Saint Joseph. Do you know what Joseph, the name Joseph, means? It means may Jehovah add and give increase. Comfort, rest, quiet. Let me tell you something. Don't you find it ironic that the two governmental agencies that are all about the earth and the and space are called NOAA and the other NASA. Look, I looked at the NOAA website this morning. And do you know what? They had no warnings on there. They were not even reporting in their alerts about all these dams that are overflowing. They only had an alert for the ones that were already destroyed. That's it. And you know, God revealed something to me a long time ago about NASA. You know, I knew that word in the Hebrew. I knew I did. And it was like it caught my eyes, okay? And it's like one day I was just thinking about it, and it was like, NASA, you know? Isn't that a word? Nassau? Isn't that it? NASA? Isn't that in the Word of God? And I'm like, yes. Yes, it is. And you know, it means to carry away, make an insurrection, to take. To lift in a great variety of applications, literally or figuratively, absolutely and relatively, as followers, as follows. Accept, A-C-C-E-P-T, to like accept something. Advance, arise, to armor, to bear up, bring forth, burn, carry away, cast, contain, desire, ease, exact, extol, fetch, to be on high, to lift self up, to be lofty, marriage, marry, magnify, raise up, receive, regard, respect, set up, spare, stir up, swear, take away, take up, utterly, wear, yield. You know, there's duality in this, because when it's pertaining to what God's doing, then it's His almighty power. But when it's in the power of men and they use this is Baal worship. This is what Bama was. It's on high. It's to lift up, to be lofty. Well, Mary, well, either you're going to be married to Jesus Christ or you're going to be married to the Antichrist, the devil. Yeah. Think about this. Isn't that amazing? And what did NASA do yesterday? Oh, we have found 7 planets like Earth. First of all, 7. You know, God's perfect creation, right? Number. Earth's perfection number. The number 7. Means God's resurrection, spiritual completeness, Father's perfection. Okay? Because you want to know who their Father is. And these are light years away. And, they, you know, they're getting us all ready to accept alien life is what they're trying to do. And isn't it just so amazing that they can see planets out there light years away, but they can't even tell you we're planet 9 or planet 10 or whatever they want to call it. They're saying, oh, there's a planet in our solar system and it's doing these things, but we can't find it. I mean, and why is all their renditions? Where's the real pictures, everybody? It's always an artist painting that looks real. Or, you know, some kind of... It's not the real thing. What in the world, everybody? We are being so deceived and lied to. I'm telling you, they're getting ready. They're getting ready. We're going to see things with our eyes that are going to be unbelievable. We're going to hear things with our ears that we're going to... You want, is this really happening? You remember I did that study, who can we trust in now? We better be putting our trust in our Lord and Savior. And I found something really interesting, and then I'm going to let you go. I want to remind you of a really important thing in the Word as it pertains to the woman and Revelation 12. When she goes to the wilderness, remember, she's going to be under the instruction and guidance of the 2 witnesses also. But remember that verse 14 says, which 14 means deliverance and salvation, everyone. Okay? So this proves it's deliverance. And verse 14 says, And to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place where she is nourished for a time, and times, and half a time from the face of the serpent. I want you to now go to Exodus chapter 19. And remember, 19 means faith. And it is our faith, and it's our obedience to that faith. God has us in his protective wing. So we're going to start with verse 1 real quick. In the third month. Now remember, their year is not the same as ours. So their year begins at the spring equinox. All right. In the third month, when the children of Israel were gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day came they into the wilderness of Sinai. For they were departed from Rephidim and were come to the desert of Sinai, and had pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before the mount. Now this is where Moses was given the Ten Commandments and everything. If you have ever looked on Google Earth, go look at the area that's around in the Sinai Peninsula, okay? And right there in the Middle East, and zoom around in it. And I'm going to tell you something. There's some amazing things that appear in the geography there. It's like a story written in there. And I couldn't believe what I saw. I mean, I saw a skull. It looked like something demonic. Over where Israel is, I see a dog's head. And it looks like it has a bird on top of the head, the dog of the head. And the bird is facing the opposite direction of the bird. And it's just amazing. If you just go to Google Earth and put in Sinai Peninsula, it's just amazing, because this is where they were when they left Egypt. And the promised land was Jerusalem, you know, Israel, the land of Israel. And they didn't get to go in there. They were out there in that wilderness. And if you just look at that on Google Earth, it's just amazing, everybody. But anyway, so verse 3, and Moses went up to God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel, you have seen what I did unto the Egyptians, and how I bare you on eagle's wings and brought you unto myself. Listen, it's amazing, because he's telling us what he's going to do. Exodus has a lot to do with Revelation and the Bride of Christ. It really does. Verse 5. Now remember, 5 is grace. We are under grace now. And this is how, through our obedience in Christ and everything we've been talking about for quite a long time, is how we do our obedience. Now therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant. Now, what we're under the new covenant. Jesus Christ has to be our first love, everyone. Then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. Peculiar treasure. It means to shut up. Wealth as closely shut up. A jewel, a peculiar treasure. Proper, good, special. See? He has everything closely tightened up around us, everybody. And he will mount us up like eagle's wings. And that is what he did. That is what he did. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. And Moses came and called for the elders of the people, and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. Isn't that amazing? And I do believe there's an Isaiah also where it's the eagle's wings. Yes, Isaiah 40. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Yeah, isn't that amazing, everybody? So we must wait upon the Lord, everyone. We really have to wait upon Him, and that means we bind together with Him as a body. He will collect us. He will bind us up together. It means even perhaps by twisting. To expect, gather, together, look, patiently, tarry, and wait for upon. Yes, isn't that amazing? As in a cord. A threefold cord. Yeah. And then it says, but they wait upon the Lord and shall renew, slide by, hasten on the way, pass on, spring up, pierce, or change, abolish, alter, charge, cut off, go on forward, grow up, be over, pass through, on, away, renew, sprout, strike through. Listen, this is what He's going to be doing, everybody. To pass on of time to pass. We're going to go in to Him. We will be walking with the Holy Spirit poured out like it's never been poured out before, everybody. We will be changed. And then at the seventh trumpet, we will be changed in the twinkling of an eye out of this flesh body. But He's going to be doing an amazing, amazing work. Because He gives power to the faint. Yep. Hast thou not known, hast thou not heard, that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is He weary? There is no searching of His understanding. He giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, He increaseth their strength. And even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Means to be firm, vigor, literally a force, a capacity to produce. A chameleon means, you know, He's going to be blending us in. He doesn't want us to be seen. He won't let anyone see us at that time. He will be protecting us. Fruits, force, might, powerful, strength, substance, wealth. Telling you, He's taking us to the other side, everybody. He's taking us to the promised land. And they shall mount up with as eagles' wings. With wings as eagles. Yes. They shall run and not be weary. And they shall walk and not faint. Isn't that amazing? The Lord is good, everybody. He really is. Well, I love you all. I'm going to go take a little rest. I've been at this for days, and I have not felt very good. So I'm going to go just recharge my battery, okay? Well, I love you all. God bless you.